All right, so hey, hi everybody. Is what time did you sleep last night? I mean, I'm just trying to get an idea of how awake are you? A little bit? That should be good enough. I hope I don't put you back to sleep. All right, so today I'm going to be talking about the spirit of open source. So though the topic is a little bit though the topic is very community focused, this talk is a business session. It talks about how you can use open source in a way that can help you drive your business to do better, at the same time contribute back to the community in the open source projects and products that you're using, in the projects and products that you are delivering to your customers. So it'll be a mixed session, a little bit on the community side, a lot of it on the business side as to how you can use this strategy to grow your business. So just a quick look at who I am. So I am the CEO at TakeT Technologies and Tech Joomla. I am a team lead with the user strategy and research team for Joomla. I used to be the strategic marketing manager on the Joomla team, and now I've moved on to my own team for user research and strategy. And other than that, I'm also an organizer of the Joomla Day India and part of the Joomla user group in Pune. Just a quick look at what we do at my day job. So TakeT Technologies has been working with Joomla since the last 12 years. We started working with Mambo and then moved on to Joomla when that came out. Bulk of our work is consulting and doing custom development for large enterprise clients using Joomla. And we service clients across the world. And Europe is one of our primary areas where we work. We also have another division called as AppCarvers that is focused more on web applications, modern front ends using Angular and mobile applications. Again, here there is a product and service mix. We have some products that are focused for our own Joomla products, and we do a lot of consulting work with that. We have an interesting new framework that we have released there based on Angular and Ionic. It's called Unite, and we are using that to build flexible front ends for any kind of backend web services. Primarily, most of the work we do is using Joomla as a backend for web services, and front ends could be in mobile or web or progressive web applications. So just a quick look at Tech Joomla. I don't know if you have used any of our products, but we have quite a few popular Joomla extensions for learning management. So Shika is a LMS, Quick2Cart is an e-commerce system, JGive is an extension for nonprofits and crowdfunding applications. We have been doing a lot of open source contributions across the board. Some of the key ones include a REST API for Joomla, as well as a common payments interface that all our products use, and a lot of other third-party developers use as well. So just a quick idea. I mean, I don't know if a poll has been put out, but I'd like to get an idea as to how many of you guys are developers versus business owners, or a mix of both, so that I can, you know, make my presentation in the right way. So I have this put up. If you could just use the Slido poll to just give me your a little bit about yourself, whether you're more on the business side, more on the developer side. And even if you do both, just tell me what you are more into. So you can just decide which side do you go more towards. What do you enjoy more out of it? Okay, so assuming that's all of us, that's a good mix. So I think this talk should be interesting from both angles, because it talks about how should the development be done, and it also talks about how it helps you improve your business. Okay, so the developers have increased, I think. Where is my mouse? I can't seem to. I can't get my screen back for some reason. Oh, thank you. Oh, you're taking it over. All right. Thanks. All right. So that's the question. Open source is all magical and free, But is it really free? What do you think? Not at all? So how many of you have contributed some open source project till now? And how did that make you feel? Yeah, awesome, yeah? So definitely on that side of it, right? Something really, it makes you feel powerful. It really makes you feel like you've done something good. And yeah, you're not going to keep contributing just because it makes you feel good, right? It also has to make sense. So the way I see it is it's like this, right? So giving back, contributing are all, you know, pretty selfish. I mean, they're called selfless acts. But I would say they're really, really selfish acts at the core because they make you feel so good. I mean, why would you do it otherwise, right? So the way I'd like to put it is that be a little selfish, you know, make yourself feel good and contribute back. So I just say that, you know, there is a good selfish and a bad selfish. When there is nothing like selfless, you, at the end of it, you're doing it because it makes you feel really great. So what I'd like to kind of analyze here is that how does this free open source thing really work? If there's so many people contributing and not getting paid for it, and they're just doing it because it makes them feel good, how does this entire ecosystem work? How does the economy work? How do people still keep making great products? And how can we make this economy work a little better? So how do you think this works? Is the recognition, or like you said, it makes you feel righteous? I mean, that's just for you, or maybe it, you know, it puts you in front of a lot of people and you get recognized. Is that enough? Is that enough to build all these big scaled products that are getting built? Almost all of you have a Joomla-based business, I suppose, right? Or you are using Joomla for your business in some way. Is that a correct assumption? And do you realize that there are so many mouths being fed, there are so many businesses being run of a product that doesn't really have strategic contribution happening all the time. It's all individuals, people who are feeling good when the contribution happens, that is sustaining something, that is sustaining so many other business models. But don't you think that's a little risky? What if people stopped feeling the need to contribute? What if people got burnt out? That would create a lot of problem for a lot of these businesses and economies that have built on top of this, right? So the question is, I mean, that's what I think. I mean, that on the right, do you recognize what that is? Yeah, weed. So, I mean, when you contribute, you feel great. You know, you'll get a high, you'll feel extremely creative, you'll feel extremely driven. But if you do too much of it, that's going to create problems. And we have seen this in the community. I don't know how many people's wives have left them, or husbands for that matter. But I'm sure it does get very crazy when you are so driven, and then after a while, it basically leads to burnout. So it's important that everybody that is getting benefited from the projects that we use, we chip in some way that we can. And what we have found is that this doesn't need to cost you, especially if you are doing something that is so related with the projects that you use. You can drive your entire business strategy in such a way that it is completely built on contribution. And I can tell you with experience that it will actually give you a huge amount of benefits. So that's the question. When I say individual contributors versus companies, I'm talking about contributors that are contributing because they feel like contributing. And when I say companies, it also means, you know, freelancers or anybody that is using the project to, you know, give services or build products on top. So can we have more people from commercially driven companies contributing back to the project? If we can drive that, then we can solve a lot of the burnout problems. What I've also seen is that somebody talked about user notes in the morning, right? So in the main session, right? David was talking about user notes. How do you think that feature got into Joomla? Why do you think it got in? Anybody knows the history about user notes? I don't, I'm actually asking a question. So maybe some client, you know, called up and said, I need a way to, you know, just store some information about the users, who is, you know, bad on the forums or whatever. I mean, just keep some record there. And that came as a PR. I don't know if it was ever validated as to does everybody really need this. But it came probably from some need, but it wasn't validated. That is this something that 80% or 90% of Joomla's users need or not? But it got built and it got in, right? So necessarily, I would say that when I would rather have contributions that are need-driven, but of course with the right analysis happening, whether this makes sense for the entire universe that Joomla as a product serves, then we would have contributions that make more sense than having things that are done just because somebody likes to do it. Because for a product, at the end of the day, I don't think our end users really care whether we use, you know, open source or closed source or whatever, as long as we solve a problem. So they do care about a product that makes sense to them, a product that can, you know, solve their problems. So the way I see it is that if done right, contribution and common code just makes sense. It just has to be designed properly. So that's the way I see it. I mean, don't reinvent the wheel. Try and use what's available. But what's very important, I think, is that it's not just about using what's there. It's also about improving it. How many times has it happened that, you know, you delivered something to the client and you got feedback that needed a change in the Joomla core? Maybe you got it done at that point with an override or a plugin or something, but you thought that, you know, this could help everybody. I'm sure everybody gets a lot of feedback like that, you know, some changes that could make sense for everyone. So if you can ensure that when you get a request like that, instead of keeping it to your project only, you contribute it upstream, it makes a lot of sense because there's more help once it's up there. It does mean that it's, you know, a little bit harder to get it into the core. There'll be plenty of discussions. People have a lot of other opinions about it. Sometimes it will mean that you can't deliver it in the timeline you're promising your client. But I would definitely ask you to give it a shot, because a lot of these changes sometimes are small. Sometimes they don't get as controversial as the bigger ones. And that can just get you a contribution that saved you a hell lot of time in maintaining it later. Because if you hack it, fork it, even if you make an override, it does mean that you have to keep maintaining it with every release of Joomla. So if you can get things into the core that makes sense to everyone, it's just a lot more easy to maintain. It's cheaper for you in the long run. It's cheaper for the client in the long run as well. So that's the way I see it. I mean, this is a rule we have in our company. So now we have around 70, 75 developers, and we have a key performance indicator that's measured every month for these guys. And they have to contribute to some open source project as one of their monthly deliveries. It's okay if it's just a language constant improvement. It could be anything, but it's important that they contribute, and we do that as a rule, as a key performance indicator in the company. And we have seen that it gives amazing results. It helps people think in a different way. Because if you're only thinking of how I can solve this client's problem, then you'll get one solution. But if you think that, you know, I have to solve the client problem and at the same time contribute somewhere in the stack, then they will think in a very different way. And probably they'll think in a way that solves not just that client's problems, but maybe, you know, problems for a few more people. So that's what we say. If you're not using common code and if you're not improving common code, at the end of the day, you have less time to innovate and you will be, you know, doing more code maintenance all the time. So the question is, when do you decide? When do you contribute? Everybody does. So do you guys maintain your own products, or do you do consulting work with clients? I mean, can you give me some examples?
I only come to you when I find a bug and get the feedback for it.
Okay. But I mean, I'm not asking you when do you contribute. What I'm saying is that as your day job, does it involve maintaining your own project products, or is it consulting work for clients?
I do custom components.
Custom components, all right. Everyone is doing some level of custom development, custom components. Perfect. So the question there is that you're right now contributing, like you said, when you find a bug and you need to solve it. The way I see it is that actually there are a lot more opportunities to contribute. It's just about finding them. And the way I see it is that you should contribute at every possible opportunity. And if these opportunities come through you to your projects, it makes sense to do it. You don't have to spend special time, you know, on a weekend to fix that bug. You can do it as part of your job. So obviously, I think everybody knows, you know, why you should contribute. So the way I see it is, you obviously get the recognition, and one thing is for sure, you get your code tested for free. You know, plenty of people out there to come and, you know, you can get a lot of shit about contributing, but that is good feedback. A lot of times you'll get a lot of perspective about how a certain thing could be built. So there's plenty of feedback. You'll get a lot of experience in how code should be engineered, how should you think about designing your solution. So there's plenty of experts out there in the community that'll come and give contributions and feedback. Of course, you need to have, I'll say you need to have a heart of steel to contribute, because when you contribute something, don't expect, you know, to be welcomed with a red carpet kind of a scenario. Sometimes you'll be appreciated, but a lot of times you'll get feedback that you might feel is negative, you might feel is not in the right spirit. But the way I see it is that if you take it with a pair of, you know, put a screen in between and just screen out the important parts, then there's a lot of learning to be done out of that feedback. Finally, one thing that I see is that you will, if it does get in, eventually you don't have the entire responsibility of maintaining that code. Once it's in the core, it's everybody's responsibility. And the more adoption you get, so the way I see it is, it's not just, so creating common code or creating open source projects is just the start. It's really depends on how much adoption it gets. So when you put it something in the core, the more people adopt it, the more problems people will find it in, and it'll get way more stable. So the higher it is in the stack, the chances are that it gets way more eyes on it, instead of, you know, just staying in your own company repository, where it'll be, you know, accessed by very limited people, and, you know, you'll get very less footage on it. So this is how we typically work. So whenever we get a client project, the first thing that people are asked is that, A, you will decide how much of this is going to be custom work, which custom, you know, open source products or extensions are you going to use. And then even the custom work is divided into two parts: what can be an open source contribution and what needs to be client specific. And this is the question that we ask every time we get a new project: what are we going to give back? How are we going to design it in such a way that we can give back something? It doesn't always have to be a, you know, contribution to the core. It could be a new extension that we, you know, open source, or a new library that we open source. But at the end of the day, more adoption you get somewhere on that level, it ends up being for the better. So this is the key thing, I think. If you can tie in contribution to your actual production process, then you can make it successful. It's not always easy, but if you can make it a part of your company culture, then this can go a long way, because otherwise it becomes really hard. So this is a typical process, right? You will work with your clients, do the requirement gathering, do some solution architecture, work on the UX, and then get into how you'll organize the custom code, which extensions would you use, et cetera, et cetera. So it's important that you make the decision whether you are kind of going to contribute and what can be common code very early up in the game. So if you can start designing your solutions in such a way that you will create more common code, then eventually it'll give you a lot of value. So typically in our case, the design decision is made right at the top, right after the requirement gathering phase is over. When we design the solution, we say that, you know, we could use this ready thing. It's just like deciding whether you use WordPress or Joomla, and when you use Joomla, which extensions are you going to use. So this is one decision later, that whatever customization is going to be done, can we contribute some of that back? So yes, it does take detailed planning. It'll probably take a little more work to do it with this approach than it would, and it would probably be a little bit more costly as well initially. But in the long run, we have seen that it gives a lot of benefits. So this is your typical process where you're doing requirement gathering, and, you know, finally what we try and do, this is the goal, that if you look at it, I have broken it up into the stack into various parts. So even the common knowledge, standards, documentation, I consider that that's not common code, but it is still a common knowledge base. So even if as part of the delivery, you can contribute somewhere in the stack, whether it's on the knowledge level, whether it's somewhere in the server stack, you might create a deployment script, whether it's the Joomla core platform or the CMS, or you create a new library, even that's a contribution. Then we have something called as infrastructure extensions that I'll talk about. So if you look at Joomla, for example, user management, I consider it's an infrastructure extension. Any new extension that you create, you don't create user management again. You will just extend what is there. So that's like an infrastructure extension. So a lot of times we create our own infrastructure extensions, which can be used by other extensions as a base to build upon. So you can contribute somewhere in the stack. And the goal typically is that we want to keep the client-specific pieces thinner. So the bespoke pieces, we try to keep them as thin as possible. And this is where the client IP goes. This is where the client specific intelligence goes. With any project, you will have a lot of, even if you do really, high-tech stuff, still the stuff that needs to be specific to the client, the stuff that needs to be protected, needs to be their IP, is still not a huge amount compared to everything else that you're doing. And generally, we find that clients agree with this because they will get a lot of benefit of using ready source code and improving ready source code. And this is being followed everywhere, right? So you'll see that whatever is generic is being pulled back into something like Joomla or some kind of open source system. So this is done, it's being done, and it's commercially viable as well. So I'll just show you some case in actions as to how we have done this. So one of the first that we got out there was our common payments API that we released quite a few years back. So again, the idea was the same. We had one e-commerce related extension back then, and we were building quite a few more. So it made a sense that we shared the code base for our own use. And when we created that, we open sourced it, and we saw that other people came and started contributing to it. Now we have lots of other third-party developers using the same common interface, and it also means that the payment plugins that are being built are not just being maintained by us. And believe me, payment plugins are a big beast to maintain. Their APIs are changing, they will change their security standards all the time, and it's a huge amount of time to test. So the more people maintaining it, it's a lot less work for us. So today we have all these guys already using this common code base. So you all have heard about the concept of JoomlaX, right? You've heard about JoomlaX? Nobody's heard about JoomlaX? Okay, you have, yeah. So, So that's when this word actually originated. Vertical extensions and horizontal extensions. And what a horizontal extension does is that it provides infrastructure for all your specific use case scenarios. So let's say you are building an e-commerce website, the e-commerce checkout is the specific, but the infrastructure that you need for it, whether it's the payment libraries, whether it's the user management, all the common things, that's kind of the horizontal, that's on top of what your vertical solution will sit on. So we kind of took that concept up, though Joomla 4 is not here yet. We built a lot of these horizontal extensions over the last couple of years. And the whole idea was that whether it was our own projects or the products that we build, we wanted to not do the same things over and over again, try and reuse as much as we can. And this is how I see the core Joomla horizontal extensions. So if you look at it, user management, categories, tags, fields, all of these, menus, languages, search, versioning, media, all of these are horizontal extensions. The only vertical Joomla really has probably is articles, the content management system, so to say. And all the other extensions that you install in there, they will use all the infrastructure that is provided to extend. So what we did is that we thought that we should expand this list of horizontals that Joomla has. And we came up with quite a few more horizontal extensions. So now we have a role-based access control system that is used in all our projects. So whenever the Joomla ACL kind of fails, not so much fails, it becomes complicated to use it. We use the role-based access control. We have a user hierarchy management system that's used in our learning management tool and a lot of other projects. Wherever you need an organization hierarchy, where there is a manager and users under him, and you need to have the manager see data for these users or assign content to them. So the user management, the user hierarchy infrastructure takes care of that. Then there are REST APIs. We also built something called as UCM. So if you guys are familiar with UCM as a content concept, it's called Unified Content Model. So this was introduced by eBay back in a long time back in Joomla 1.5, 1.6 days. It never really made it out. But using the same concept, we built a small CCK that we use for all our projects, for form building, content building, and things like that. We have a reporting infrastructure and a dashboards infrastructure now, where you can just put in plugins and generate reports with CSV exports, Ajax, report customization. We have Algolia Solar infrastructure, which will let us index anything in Joomla with Algolia or Solar to provide powerful search. And there's quite a few more. So there's also a notification system that we are trying to get into the core of Joomla. So think of it like an email manager and a SMS manager and a push notifications manager that can manage all the content for notifications in the Joomla core. And third-party extensions simply push their templates to it. So all our extensions already use these infrastructure extensions. So there's quite a few more. So these we have evolved purely by thinking in the spirit of open source way. Just by saying that, you know, I need reporting everywhere, so why don't I build it as infrastructure? Or I need dashboarding everywhere. Instead of building modules all the time, why don't I create infrastructure that can I can use across our products and service offerings? And the value that we have out of this is now that any new extension that we come out with comes inbuilt with all this. And we are not spending much time at all. I mean, I would not say we had to spend any extra time in building these things in this way. Probably 10%, 15% more time on the design side, but the practical implementation was time was still the same. And now we have, and all of this is open source, by the way. All these horizontal extensions, they are not commercial open source, they are free open source. They are on our GitHub. You can go and try it, you can go and use it. And there is an intention behind that. The more people use it, this is the kind of a lot of the enterprise pieces that are missing in Joomla are in here. So you can easily take on larger projects that Joomla out of the box won't be able to let you do. Of course, it means that you'll have to help us maintain it, but that's the whole idea, right? That the more people that can use it, the more likely they are to contribute back to it. So you can check out our GitHub. It's github.com/techjoomla and github.com/appcovers for a lot of these infrastructure extensions. So these are just a few sayings that I'll ask to keep with you, tweet if you like. So one thing is very important that if you are downstream, if people are using your code to, you know, improve their own extensions, don't dissuade them. The more people that contribute, for example, if you decide to use a reporting engine, I would more than welcome it, because the more people that use it, even if it's free, it means that you'll come back to me with bugs, you'll come back to me with fixes. So if you don't dissuade your downstream projects and if you help them grow, they are going to contribute back. So it's important that you create a downstream to your own code base. Again, the success of any open source project can only be sustainable if people that are downstream contribute back. So if you're using any open source project, it's not just about Joomla, try and give something back. It doesn't have to be something big. And again, you don't have to do it in spare time. If you can design your workflows correctly, you can do it as part of your client delivery. And the client will pay you for it effectively. So just design your projects in a way that drive contribution. So if you have any products that are downstream to open source projects, so if you are managing Joomla extensions, obviously it makes sense for you to contribute back. So whether it's custom projects or products that you have downstream to something like Joomla, if you're not contributing back, just start contributing a little. If you can do it, it can make a world of a difference. So this is how I see the Joomla ecosystem. I have written a pretty big blog about it. You can read about the sustainable Joomla ecosystem. It's a large blog on Medium. But this is what we have right now, right? So there is the Joomla core platform. The guys in green up there are the contributors who are contributing on their own time. And then we have all these ecosystem companies who are kind of earning money off this. So whether it's extension developers, system integrators, consulting agencies, template developers, even hosting companies and value-added services like, you know, MyJoomla. This is the commercial ecosystem around this. And this is what I call the Joomla as a Joomla market. If these guys can contribute back, and you'll see that all the people that are working on their own time, they can only provide limited time. They're not getting specially paid to do this. That is completely getting driven by however what open source works. But it also means that it puts brakes on the speed that we can achieve. So if we can get this ecosystem to contribute more than what it does now, the speed at which we could drive things would go in a big way. And as I said earlier, it would be more need-driven contribution than, you know, just passion-driven contribution. If we know what our end users want, and these are the guys that are talking to the end users, right? If you look at our end users, it's these guys that take Joomla to end users. These are the guys who can tell us what Joomla really needs to be. Because when you try and go and sell Joomla to somebody and they say, I can't use Joomla because, that because is what you need to take back, either as a contribution or as feedback, so that the product can evolve in the right way. So I won't really talk much about this. As I said, there's a pretty detailed research that I've done over the last 2 years as to how Joomla could evolve, not just in the Joomla as a Joomla ecosystem, but as distributions to end users. Because one of the reasons I believe there has been a change is that if you've seen in the last 10 years, the internet has evolved in a very different way. 10 years back, there were more, you know, geeks on the internet. Now there are more consumers on the internet. So obviously, things like Facebook and Wix, which are built for consumers, are going to get more market share. If you get WordPress is very close to that kind of a scenario. It's more closer to end users. So it is very, very natural that they will get more market share. If we try and get that market from there, it's a very, very uphill task. But if we can use Joomla as a basis to create products that are specifically built for specific problems for end users, and this can be done with distributions, then we'll be able to achieve better market share without having to, you know, break a lot of things. So it's important that we decide who our end user is. Again, that's what I talk about this. I think there is a good session about that today, later today, who is Joomla's end user. That's exactly the exploration that I've done in this, and I do a normally a different talk about this. But I would definitely ask you to Google this and read this. I would love your feedback. If it's right, if it's wrong, anything that we can do to improve in this. So that's the contribution target. What I'd like all of you to do is, now we have some 12, 15 people in this room. If you can go back to your own companies with a 30% contribution target, any project that you do next, can you contribute 30% back? Can you design it in such a way that you can give 30% back? Then I think we'll make a huge impact. That's a lot of, I mean, we have projects that where we have done something like 70%, 80% common code. You can do that if it's designed right. Of course, you need to get the right clients who understand this way of working. Not everybody will agree. But usually, if they are in it for the long run, they will see that there is a lot of value in working like this. Because it's sustainable for them, it's cheaper because they are getting to use ready code. And it's also sustainable for us because we can add value on both sides. So that's my question to you. Where will you contribute next in the stack in your next project? So that's about it. So unless you have any questions, let's make an impact. So thank you. So any of you guys work like this? Or have tried to do this and have faced issues, problems? Because one I typically get is that, you know, I tried to make this contribution to the Joomla core. Joomla is, it's 3 years now, Joomla has still not accepted it. Obviously my client project got delivered a long time ago. Then how do I make this work? Because that's one common one that I get all the time. And that's definitely a risk, but there are ways to manage that as well and still keep doing it, because the things that get stuck like this probably are lesser than the ones that will go through. All right, thank you.